For decades, we've heard politicians and the media lambast public schools as failing and broken and denounce the corrupt teachers' unions for protecting lazy and bad teachers. If you look at the statistics, that appears to be the case. You see a story of declining test scores and mediocre student performance. In 2018, the United States performed worse than Lithuania and Vietnam in mathematics on international testing. The antidote prescribed by the establishment experts is simple: privatization and deregulation. But what if they're wrong? What if the root causes plaguing our public schools are instead poverty, hypersegregation, and chronic disinvestment? What if we examine public schools not as isolated institutions, but within a larger political and economic context that deprives children, families, and their communities of basic livelihoods? In the late 1980s, renowned writer Jonathan Kozol barnstormed the country for 2 years, visiting and documenting his observations in schools in urban and suburban neighborhoods. Reporting from East St. Louis, he noted in his harrowing book, Savage Inequalities, that schools were overcrowded. Children did not have sufficient books, paper, computers, and other resources. Science labs were outdated by a half century. And improper heating made some classrooms freeze and others boil, sometimes reaching 100 degrees. As Kozol put it, one searches for some way to understand why a society as rich and frequently as generous as ours would leave these children in their penury and squalor for so long, and with so little public indignation. Contrary to popular belief, more than a quarter century later, public schools across the United States remain starved of resources. That's because the U.S. is unique in how it funds schools. School funding is determined largely by local property taxes, meaning that wealthy, largely white children are educated in gleaming palaces, while poor, Black, Latino, and Indigenous children are often confined to crumbling schools with crowded classrooms, zero tolerance discipline, poorly paid teachers and staff, and lack of access to school nurses, librarians, and social workers. Consider a tale of two school systems. In rich, predominantly white Lower Merion, a suburb of Philadelphia, schools spend more than $26,000 per student. And just a few miles away, the diverse Philadelphia schools, which serve predominantly poor and working class children, spend less than $15,000 per student. This is a nationwide phenomenon. In 2016, majority minority school districts received $23 billion less in funding than majority white districts, despite serving the same number of students. This is apartheid-style education. Instead of addressing these inequities, the federal government has doubled down on a market-based approach. Private foundations, think tanks, and both Democratic and Republican officials have fought for a corporate makeover of the public education system. They champion austerity measures, high-stakes standardized testing, school closures, expansion of no-excuses charter schools, a weakening of teachers' unions, and stiff disciplinary methods. This has been the major approach of education reform for the last two decades. In 2001, the No Child Left Behind Act, signed into law by President George Bush with bipartisan approval, imposed stringent testing measures for elementary and middle school students. Those schools that didn't make adequate annual progress risked being labeled as a failing school, having all or parts of its staff fired, shut down, converted into a charter school, taken over by the state, or privatized. Then there was a race to the top program, a $4 billion grant competition under the Obama administration. In order to qualify for federal education funding, states were required to adopt an ensemble of policies in their schools: performance-based teacher evaluations, more standardized tests, more charter schools, and more interventions in failing schools, closures, privatizations, and takeovers. Under the logic of the school reformers, superintendents get called CEOs. Schools in poor communities, especially Black, Latino, and Indigenous ones, are ranked, sanctioned, shut down, and turned over to private management based on student test scores. Teachers are fired and punished based on student performance, and their ratings are sometimes published in newspapers. Segregated charter schools are opened to create an educational free market to promote competition with public schools. In New York City alone, more than 100,000 students, or 1 in 10 in the city, were homeless. About 34,000 of them came to school from homeless shelters. Millions more children across the U.S., about 15% of all children, live in poverty. It is one of the highest rates in the industrialized world. That rate is far above the 4% figure in Scandinavian countries. Former Secretary of Education Arne Duncan once said that it is opportunity, not poverty, that shapes children's destiny. But we know the effects of poverty on children: malnutrition, stunted development, mental illness, and low academic achievement. If the corporate school reformers were really committed to making life better for the poorest children in our country, they would stop making such asinine comments and declare, as educator Kenzo Shibata once said, "Poverty shouldn't be, period." It's not actually that hard to imagine what is necessary to transform the lives of the most vulnerable. It doesn't require more charter schools or more standardized testing. Rather, in line with other countries, we could guarantee an unconditional sum of $250 a month per child, per family, to pay for diapers, food, clothing, and other childcare costs. This measure alone would cut the child poverty rate by 40% and slash deep poverty in half. It would be the most substantive expansion of the social safety net for children in the modern history of the United States. If we are to guarantee an equitable public education worthy of the dignity of all children, there is no better place to begin than waging an assault on the moral scandal of child poverty in the wealthiest nation in the history of the world. I'm Nikhil Goyal, sociologist and PhD candidate at the University of Cambridge for the Gravel Institute.